Hello everyone and welcome to Medford Anywhere Learning TV. We're glad you're tuned in. We want to give a shout out to our friends at Southern Oregon PBS, KTVL, KDRV, and the Dove Network. Thank you for hosting us on your station. In the Medford School District, we have one shared vision, and that we believe that all are learning, and learning is for all. And what better place to do that than right here on Medford Anywhere Learning TV.
We need more electricity! More! It's alive! It's moving! It's alive!
Oh, it truly is a monster!
A monster? Well, today's episode is all about electricity. It's really shocking. Are you ready? Then let's go in 3, 2, 1. Hello, and welcome to another exciting episode of Science Rewind, where I rewind the science for you. Today, it's all about electricity. So where does electricity come from? I mean, when I'm in my house and I plug in the toaster, or I charge my phone, or I use the hairdryer, my toaster or phone, I often just think the electricity will always be there or always be on. But where does it come from? I mean, does it like live in the walls? Does it just go through wires whenever we need the electricity? Well, actually, the answers are very interesting. So I would like to talk to you about how we can produce electricity from different sources. So to do that, though, we have to go to where those sources are. And remember, electricity is energy. And energy is never created or destroyed. It just goes from one form to another. Electricity is the same way. So I have invented this. Is a electronic tricorder unit. This will be used to go from one location to another through a portal. I hope this works. I've only done it one time and it wasn't a good result. All right, here we go. Are you ready? Turning it on now, and here we go. It works! See you there. Wow, that was so great. Well, here we are, we made it. So I'm standing in front of solar power cells, wind turbines, and power plants. All of those three things help to generate electricity. How does it work out? Well, the solar cells, they get photonic energy from the sun. And what happens is, as the sun rays hit those cells, they excite the electrons of the atoms that are in those cells, and it causes them to run more freely and to produce electricity. The wind turbines that are behind me spinning, you can see those big white blades rotating. Well, there's an interesting control box in those turbines that will face the wind wherever the wind is blowing to get the most potential wind power from whatever direction the wind is blowing. And that helps spin a generator that's inside of those big long towers that hold those big propellers. It spins and spins and creates electromagnetic energy or electricity. And the power plants behind me, well, those could be like nuclear or coal burning or oil or natural gas or even electric. They can all produce more electricity. It's pretty incredible. But there's another place or location that you probably have driven past lots of times and not even realized or thought that that place or location can actually produce electricity. You want to find out where that place is? Let's go. This is so fun. Whoa, okay, wow. Well, here we are in front of a hydroelectric dam. How does a dam help produce electricity? Well, dams, of course, they stop flow of water. And so there's a reservoir that's behind each of the dams. The water then is let into the dam, into the turbines, which then turn bigger motors called generators. And those generators help to produce electromagnetic energy, which of course is electricity. Then the electricity is then sent out through high-powered wires, through big tall towers called pylons, which are right behind me to my left, out to different substations. Substations are found in all different cities. Substations help to take the electricity and step it down for our home use. Let's go find out more about substations. Here we go. Wow. Well, here we are. We're right in front of a substation. So what is exactly a substation? Well, remember when like dams or turbines or power plants or solar cells, when they produce electricity, that electricity is going to be produced in high voltage to go from one area to another. It has to travel a very long distance through power lines so it can go from the source of where it's being produced to our homes. Substations are really good at taking that voltage and stepping it down for our home use. Remember, if you plug in your appliance, you don't want your appliance to like blow up because there's too much voltage. Think of it like this, like water going into your home, water pressure. If the water pressure is too great, what happens? The pipes could burst. Well, too much voltage and well, your wires could melt or cause a fire. So we don't want that. So substations are really great at taking the voltage and stepping it down for our own home use. Well, that's all about substations. Now let's go back to the classroom.
All right, let's talk about the law of electric charges. And it says this, that opposite charges are attracted to each other. There's an invisible force that pulls them together. The second part is that like charges are repelled from one another. There's this force that pushes them apart. So now we're gonna see if we can see this in action. Okay, so I'm gonna take my PVC pipe, I'm gonna charge it. I'm gonna give it a negative charge. My wool here is gonna give up electrons to this plastic, this PVC. And when it does, the wool will become positive and this pipe will become negatively charged. Now I want you to watch carefully because I'm gonna take some tinsel here and I'm gonna drop this tinsel onto the pipe. And at first it's gonna be attracted to it and then watch what happens. Here we go. Okay, did you see what happened? Right when I let it go, it went immediately to the pipe because opposite charges are attracted to each other. But when it touched the pipe, now you can see what's happening. These two are repelling each other because, remember what we talked about, like charges repel.
Did you know that bubbles can also be affected by static electricity? Well, that's what we're gonna do next. So first, I'm gonna take a PVC pipe and rub it with this wool cloth. And right now I'm trying to transfer the electrons from this wool cloth onto the pipe. All right, there we go. Now it's time to blow a soap bubble. Let's see what happens. All right, you wanna see that again? So why did the soap bubble move when I brought the PVC pipe next to it? Well, remember, I'm taking electrons and rubbing them onto the PVC pipe. So this is going to be now negatively charged. And when I bring it close to the bubble, which is neutral, the positive areas in that bubble are attracted to the PVC pipe. All right. Whoa, there it goes. All right, I hope you enjoyed this demonstration.
Hello, Benjamin Franklin here, talking to you about static electricity. If you recall, I did a famous experiment with a kite, a brass key, and some silk string. What was I trying to prove? That I could be shocked. No, that static electricity can come from the clouds and down the string and make the brass key spark, which is very actually stupid of me because I could have been killed. However, I have another experiment for you. This is with a Van de Graaff generator. How does it work? Well, as I put my hand on the dome, the belt here begins to move after I turn on the power, and the electrons that were from me begin to flow down the belt and down through the wire. What's left, positive charges go up into the dome and me, and negative charges go down into the wire. Why is that important to know? Because when I touch the dome, it's positive and positive charges going against each other. They're repelling each other. So light charges repel, as we know. So let's see what happens here. Oh, I was going to take off my hat and show you my hair, but unfortunately it's a little bit too heavy and thick. However, I have another demonstration for you. It involves Mr. Franklin. Aha, yes. Well, I can't wear the Benjamin Franklin hair because it's just too much, too heavy, but I have another solution. I have some yarn hair here that I'll be using. So I'll put that to the side here and we'll see what happens when I touch the generator and I let the positive charges stay on me and the negative charges flow out. Let's find out. Here we go. Ready? Ooh, a little shock there. All right, let's see what happens. So watch the yarn hair. Ooh, right now I feel a tingling of electricity going over my body. And I believe you'll see in a little bit the yarn beginning to go up. Why is that happening? Well, because the yarn also is positively charged, as is my head. And so again, positive and positive charges want to repel. So that's why it's moving away from my head. Interesting, huh? What do you think? Is it like a brand new hairdo for me? So what would happen, do you think, if I stepped down off of these milk crates that I'm standing on and I'm grounded again? What will happen to the yarn? Will it stay up or will it go down? Well, let's find out. Here we go. Yep. So what just happened? Well, the yarn actually became what? Grounded as well, and so it was no longer positively charged. That's the Van de Graaff experiment. I have one more thing to show you though, but first I need to turn this off, so hold on. Okay, I have these pie tins here, these little small pie tins, and I'm gonna be putting them on top of the dome here. And so I want to see what happens when I turn on the generator. What's gonna happen to those tins? What's gonna happen? Well, let's find out. So positively charged, positively charged. What do you think will happen? Let's see. Okay. And I'll just turn it on right here. Here we go. Okay, let's watch. Oh, there they go. It's like a flying saucer. How cool is that? So there you go. They're positively charged, getting away from the positively charged dome. And so they repelled each other. Hey, that's science and static electricity.
All right, well, David and I have something else we want to show you about electricity. It has to do with this energy stick right here. So watch how this works. If I grab this end of it here, and David grabs this end here, nothing happens. But when I go ahead and touch, not his hand, I'll touch his head. Watch this. Did you hear that? Let's try it again. Now let's try his nose this time here. Hey, he's got a nice button for a nose, doesn't he? So what's going on here? How does this work? This energy tube here, inside of it, we've got some wires, we've got a battery, there's some lights here, and there's a sound-emitting diode. But nothing happens until this end is touched right here, and this end, this is aluminum tape. But if you notice, if Dave and I both touch it like this, the circuit is not completed because electricity can go through here, through David, but then it stops. But when we touch, we're completing the circuit. So that's how it works. Electricity always likes to go in a complete circuit. If it doesn't have a complete circuit, it doesn't go at all.
Well, we know that humans can conduct electricity. Anything that conducts electricity is called a conductor, so let's try some other materials.
Sounds good.
What about this glass straw here?
Let's check it out. What do you think, conductor or insulator? Ah, that's an insulator. An insulator is something that doesn't allow electrons to flow through it. Even though we're connected by this glass right here, electricity does not go through glass at all. That we call an insulator. I've got something to try, David. I'm gonna try this soda can right here, aluminum. What do you guys think about this? Let's try it. Aha, we've got a conductor of electricity. Electricity likes to go through aluminum, doesn't it? What else do you wanna try, David?
Well, I guess we could try this metal pipe, see what happens.
Okay, what do you guys think about this? Yes or no? Let's find out. Yep, good conductor of electricity.
It seems like metals are pretty common conductors of electricity.
Okay, well, I've got something, David. I've got this right here. There's metal right there. Let's try it.
All right.
What do you guys think? Yes or no? Ah, it's not working. Why is it not working? Maybe it's because of what I'm holding, which is wood. Let's try this here. If we both hold the metal, it does work. Wood, doesn't work at all. All right, what else do you want to explore, David? Anything else?
Well, I'm kind of curious. Would I be safe in a bathtub if I was charging my phone?
I've read many articles about that. I don't think it's a good idea. But let's give it a shot.
All right.
Okay. You put your hand in there, and I'll put my hand in this part of the water here and see what happens. You ready? I like it. I like it. So you're not safe in the bathtub charging your phone. Okay, electricity can go through this. Water is also a conductor of electricity. So we've been talking about circuits and how electricity likes to go all the way through a circuit, or else it doesn't go. We've also talked about conductors and insulators. Last question for you. This copper pipe right here, yes or no? Is it a conductor of electricity? Will electricity flow through this? You might want to think about what's inside all of your cords at home. On the rubber on the outside, but check out what's on the inside. Copper. Electricity loves a complete circuit, right? Well, let's talk about the four parts of a circuit. All of them are pretty essential. So first of all, you have to have a place for electrons to flow. We call that, remember, the conductor. We're going to be using these wires right here. These are alligator clips. You don't want to be bit by these. Okay, so we've got our conductors all the way around. The second part we'll talk about is the battery. We have to have some energy. We've got to get the electrons to flow. You see, without a battery, they sit there. They, like bumps in a log, they don't move at all until they're pulled and pushed. So we got the negative end of the battery pushing the electrons away. We got the positive end of the battery pulling them toward it. Now we can get electrons to flow. I'm gonna be using, for my battery, I'm gonna use 3 volts here of electricity, 2D batteries. All right, so now we've got another part of our circuit, which is called the switch. The switch is convenient because you can turn it on and off. We can make the electricity run, we can make it stop with our switch. And this is our switch right here. And the last part, we want electricity to be our servants, to do something for us, not just go in a circle like this. That'd be silly. We want it to do something, so we have our load. Our load is what we want the electricity to do, whether it's a light, whether it's a hairdryer, whatever it is. Electricity, in this case, is gonna make, we got a motor here, we're gonna make this fan go, because I'm hot, and I need to be cooled down. All right, you ready? Now, all I have to do to get this fan to work is to complete the circuit. Right now, it is open. I'm gonna shut the circuit. I'm gonna close it. Let's watch and see what happens. You ready? Closed. That feels so nice. All right, so let's see if you can remember the four parts of a circuit. We've got, first of all, wires. Those are called conductors. We've got the second part. We need to make the electrons move. That's our battery source. We got a switch. Now, it'll work without the switch. You don't need it, but it's sure nice to be able to turn things on and off, right? And the last part is the load. In this case, it's our fan that makes it work. All right. Now let's take a look at one other circuit. And this one will light a light bulb. I'm gonna use this right here, this power supply for my energy source. And I've got a little light right here, a little LED light. And it works about with 3 volts of electricity. So what's a volt? Named after Alessandro Volta, who invented the first battery. You can check that out on the internet. Volts really determine how much power each electron has. The more volts, the more power, pushing power that each electron has. So watch what happens when I go ahead and turn this on here. When I get up to about 3 volts, it goes on. We have 3 volts of power. Let's see what happens when I go ahead and up the voltage. Can you see it getting brighter and dimmer and brighter and dimmer? So more volts means more power, more pushing power for those electrons, and they're able to do more work for us.
I have a problem. I'm trying to complete my circuit, and you can see that I'm missing a connection, and I can't quite reach it. I know I have my power supply, I have my switch, I have my copper pipe going all the way over to my board here, and then I have a wire from my copper pipe to the bell, which is my load. So my load, I got my switch and my power supply. You know what I'm missing? I'm missing a conductor to complete the circuit. What can I do without a conductor? Oh, a conductor? Yeah, no, not the plastic pipe. This is an insulator. Give me another one. This is for a different experiment. Not the banana. Give me no, this is a wood stick. That won't work out. I need something. Yes, this will work. The slinky's perfect. Why is this so good and these three not? Because this is a conductor. It lets the electrons flow freely where the wood yardstick, the banana, and the plastic pipe don't. They hold on to their electrons. They can't move, and that's why we don't use these items for conducting electricity, only metals and other types of materials that are good at letting the electrons flow. So let's see if this is going to work now. I'm gonna hook it up to one end of my slinky here. And there we go. And now I'm gonna see if this will hook up here. And I'll put it over my shoulder so you guys can see better. There we go. And I'll do it this way. And let's see if I throw the switch, if the bell will ring. 3, 2, 1. It works. That's a great example of a connection. We're using a conductor and the 4 parts to complete a circuit. There you go.
In this demonstration, I'm going to be using the plasma globe. And what's really cool about the plasma globe is that there's a partial vacuum inside. When I turn this on, the Tesla coil is going to separate the electrons from the particles of gas inside, leaving positively charged ions and the electrons looking for a chance to escape. When I put my hand on it, the electricity is going to flow through me and into the ground. Now let's see what happens when I put my hand on it. As you can see, when my hand is not on it, all of these electrons are trying to find a chance to escape, but when I put my hand on it, they all go through me and into the ground. Let's see what happens when I take this fluorescent tube near the plasma globe. I don't even have to touch the plasma globe. As soon as I get it near, the electric field around it is activating it and causing the light. Let's do one more demonstration with my dad.
So now watch what happens when I touch the end right here. Electrons are going to travel from the globe through David to David's hand through the tube, and they're going to stop right here. Why is this up part not lit? It's because the electrons now are gonna leave through my hand and go to the ground. Now watch what happens when I slide my hand back and forth. You can see that I'm completing the circuit and the electricity now is going through me. I'm gonna try one more thing now. This time, I'm gonna go ahead and touch David's hands. What do you think is gonna happen? Watch this. Anybody figure out what's going on? We got a little switch here, don't we, David? And so when I touch David's hand, the electricity is a little bit lazy, and the charge, instead of going up through the tube and lighting it, it's going right through me to the ground. So now this is called a short circuit, by the way. We've short circuited it. Pretty cool, huh? Let's try one more thing now. This time, we'll take our energy stick.
we're gonna find out how far this electric field actually travels. So when I bring this close, let's see what happens. Listen. Can you hear that? Right about there, about 2 feet away, this gets activated, which means it's completing, this electric field is completing this circuit right here. Pretty cool, huh? David, go ahead and put your hand on that there. And now put your other hand over here. Let's see what happens when I bring this close to David's hand here. I've got my power supply right here. It's 120 volts. I've got a switch right here on and off. And I have a conductor, this wire right here. It's gonna carry my electricity. What am I missing? Let's see. Something for the electricity to do. I need a load. Hey, load! Tangerine. No. Apple? Electricity? Load? Nah. There's the banana again. No, no, not the banana. Let's see what else you got. A pickle. I think I've got an idea. Let's go ahead and plug our pickle in to 120 volts here. And let's see what happens when I turn this switch on. Okay, good, little juicy guy there. All right, are you ready to see what happens when 120 volts go through this pickle? This is our load. Let's see what kind of work it can do. Here we go. I hear something. Oh, and I smell something. And, oh, I'm starting to see something. Whoa, oh, did you see that? Whoa, we've turned it into a light bulb. Hey, our pickle is glowing and smoking a lot too. Wow. Hey, the next time that you need a light, just get a pickle and 120 volts of electricity, and there you go. All right, better turn it off now. Thanks for watching.
Well, that wraps up another episode of Science Rewind, and it was all about electricity. I really hope that you enjoyed watching the information and you learned something. If you have any questions or comments, please email me at the address below. I would love to hear from you. In fact, I have one from, it's from a parent. Her name is Samantha. She said, "Dear Mr. Franklin, I noticed that you talked about elephant toothpaste, but you never showed us the actual experiment. Well, my son Ben did the mini experiment, but we didn't have time to do the big experiment because we just didn't have enough time. So we ran out of that space. But listen, go on to Google, YouTube, probably has the experiment. You can probably watch it there, okay? Now I'm gonna go ahead and show you my electronic tricorder unit, which was sitting right here on the table. Does anybody see my electronic tricorder unit? That's strange. Well, anyway, as always, stay healthy, stay learning, and we'll see you next time on Science Rewind. Where's my unit?
Thanks for tuning in to Medford Anywhere Learning TV. Medford School District is a place where all are learning, and learning is for all.